Welcome to the Rustic Garden. Today I want to talk about calcium. It's one of six macronutrients. The main macronutrients you're used to seeing are phosphorus and potassium. And they're usually called the primary macronutrients. That's what you see in all the fertilizer packs. But there's also calcium, magnesium, and sulfur. They are also macronutrients. And macronutrients are really the six elements your garden really has to have in the right quantity for your plants to really thrive. Today we're going to talk about calcium. Before I get to the benefits of calcium, I just want to let you know most garden soils will have calcium in there, so you're not going to initially start out having a problem, and that's true for most of the fertilizers. But as you garden for a while, sometimes you have to add in these fertilizers to amend them. Sometimes your plants suck out a lot of the elements depending on what you're growing. So you need to really understand what they are, and that's my goal, is for you to understand what calcium is. I'll show you a couple of products and you can decide how you want to use it. Calcium benefits. Calcium is mostly a carrier molecule. You really need calcium in your plant because it transports the essential nutrients in and out of the plant cells. It's going to move carbohydrates, enzymes, elements, all kinds of things up and down your plant. It's really the transport sort of molecule, if you think about it, or the transport piece of the plant. If you don't have calcium, the nutrients just aren't going to move up and down the plant. It strengthens cell walls. It also helps with uptake of other elements in the soil. You have nitrogen, you have potassium in the soil. If you have too much calcium, it can combine with different elements. If you have too little, it can cause problems. So you need calcium to make sure your garden soil will give up the nutrients to your plants. And you need the right amounts. And it's very, very hard to mess up your soil by adding calcium. And I'm going to talk to you about ways that you can prevent that from happening too. Calcium deficiencies. You're going to have a stunted growth in your plant. The young leaves are going to be distorted. They're going to yellow and you're going to notice it right away. Calcium, unlike some of the other elements, you're going to notice it right away in the fruits. Well, maybe not right away, but you're going to notice as they develop. Tomatoes get blossom end rot. That's where they brown on the bottom. Celery gets black heart disease or black heart. Carrots get cavity spots, and cabbages get internal tip burn. I haven't seen this. I haven't had that happen to my plants, but I have gotten blossom end rot more so in containers, and I'll talk about container soil too as we go on. Calcium problems. Calcium is absorbed with water, so you have to have water, but you have to have regular levels of water in your garden, or your plants aren't going to be able to pull the calcium in. So if you have periods of drought, or times when your whole container dries out, or your garden soil dries out, you're going to have calcium issues with your plant, and that's going to show up, you know, pretty quickly. So make sure you maintain, you know, the moisture level of your garden, of your earth beds, of your containers. Too much or too little calcium can impact how nutrients are absorbed from the soil, and too much, not calcium, calcium itself, Ca, the element, won't change the pH. But too much calcium carbonate, a form of calcium, can raise the pH levels. And I'll go over that more too as we talk. But just remember, calcium, the element, Ca, won't change the pH of your soil. But that's what your plants need. They don't need calcium carbonate. They're not pulling calcium carbonate in. They're only pulling up the calcium. So a lot of these products have to will introduce a form of calcium to your soil, but the soil has to break it down into a form your plants can use. pH levels. So if you're using calcium carbonate, which really gets into your garden from a lot of different kinds of lime or use of lime, you could change your pH levels. The general range, I'm going to do a video on this down the line, but general range of pH is 6 to 7, 6.5 is optimal. We're only going to be adding low amounts of calcium products into your soil, so you don't have to worry so much about the pH level. But if you are, you could also add in some peat moss that's acidic, and that's what I tend to do, and my guess is they kind of neutralize each other. And I've been gardening in the same area for well over 10 years. I haven't had any trouble with my pH levels. Calcium, the element, Ca, is considered the building block of the fruit. So that's the most important thing to take away from calcium, is you really need it for your, for your fruit to really develop, you know, to a good size, to a good flavor. My experience is that I grow peppers in the ground, in containers, and in half-sunken containers. When I add in more calcium to those plants, Instead of having sometimes thin-walled and leathery peppers, I really find that the bell peppers have thicker walls. They're much more crispier, much more crisp, and a snap to them when I break them open. I think it's due to the calcium. Don't have 100% proof, but that's my experience. And I usually sometimes tend to neglect, for whatever reason, the right side of my garden. The other side that's getting more of the nutrients and calcium tend to do better. Blossom end rot is the main problem you're probably going to see or have seen in your garden. And that, again, is when the bottom of the tomato turns brown. And that's from an issue with calcium. Either your plant can't pull the calcium out of the soil, or you don't have enough calcium in there. It happens a lot in containers. When you have a container, I've said before, I use 5-gallon containers, I use 10-gallon containers. You put the soil in, I do add in a lot more nutrients and amendments into that soil because the plants will suck the life out of that. There's no other really way that nutrients are coming into your container soil. And then plus when it rains, that rainwater will quickly go through, go out the holes in the bottom, so you're also leaching out nutrients. So container soil really needs, I think, lime in it, or you're going to end up with blossom end rot on your tomatoes and other problems with other vegetables you might be growing. Sandy soils, if you have sandy soil, when it rains, the water goes through quickly. As it goes through, it's going to leach out different elements that's in your soil. And fast-acting calcium, if you have blossom end rot, these are eggshells, that's calcium carbonate. They would have to go in your soil, break down, slow release, takes time. This won't fix your tomatoes when there's a problem. You need a fast-acting form of calcium that just has the Ca, the element, quickly available so your plant can pull it into its system real quick and correct the problem of blossom end rot. We're going to talk about slow release and fast release. A form of slow release calcium is dolomitic lime. It's actually calcium carbonate and magnesium carbonate. These two things are not pulled directly into your plant. They have to break down in the soil so that calcium and magnesium are rendered. When you use dolomitic lime, you get the benefit of calcium and you also get the benefit of magnesium. So you get two macronutrients put into your soil. And again, it's the calcium carbonate that raises pH level. So this will go into your soil, into your container, and then over time, the soil will go through a process, break this down into a form that your plant can use. You also have a slow release form of calcium called gypsum. That's calcium sulfate, CaSO4. This will not raise your pH, but it could lower your pH. And this is a form of calcium and sulfur. So this is going to also provide some sulfur to your garden, which is another macro nutrient. Again, this has to break down into a form where the calcium is set free, the Ca is set free from the SO4. That calcium will be pulled into your plant. Your plant can use it. Slow release. It will take some time for that process to happen. Other forms of slow release calcium are eggshells. You can pulverize them down. They're mostly calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate needs to break down and free up the calcium, like I was saying. There's also a form of lime called calcite, where it's just plain old calcium carbonate. Oyster shells, I think, are also calcium carbonate. People use that, pulverize that down. But whenever you have calcium carbonate, it has to break down in some capacity to free up the plain old element Ca, calcium, so that your plant can pull it in. Hopefully that makes sense. Now we have some mixed release forms, and this is garden lime. It says garden lime. It's derived from dolomitic lime. And the reason I think it says derived is because I think there's a little bit of a chemical processing or some sort of processing, because it's not just straight calcium carbonate and magnesium carbonate. It also has calcium oxide. Calcium oxide comes from heating calcium carbonate. It's got calcium, magnesium, magnesium oxide, magnesium carbonate. And maybe they, analyze it differently and I don't quite get it. But this product, because it has available calcium, magnesium, that's going to get to your plant a little bit more quickly. And then it also has the carbonate of magnesium and calcium. That's going to have to break down and release over time. So this may be a little bit more fast-acting, not quite as slow-acting as pure dolomitic lime. Hopefully that makes sense. And if you have more information about this product and how they analyze it and how they break it down, I would really love to understand exactly, what the analysis was and why they say it's derived from dolomitic lime. It makes me think it's processed in some way. But I would recommend this, and we'll talk about dosing in a little bit. You also have, same company, you have garden gypsum. It has calcium sulfate in it, calcium sulfate dihydrate, which is the addition of H2O into it in some capacity, also has calcium and sulfur. And again, I think it's processed in some way in that, you know, the analysis says these are the components in there. And when you look at them, it's 68%, 86%, 20%. It doesn't really add up to 100%. So they're calculating it based on what's actually available in there that I quite just don't understand. However, because it has free calcium and free sulfur, this is going to work a little bit quicker for your plants. And then the sulfate as it breaks down, the calcium sulfate as it breaks down, will come available down the line. Hopefully that makes sense. Fast release. You have calcium nitrate. Calcium nitrate is actually something I just ordered 25 pounds of, and I'm going to use it in my garden as a fast release foliar spray for when I see blossom end rot and other problems that I think are related to calcium. I did a video on calcium carbonate eggshells where I pulverized it down, explained that it's only calcium carbonate and it's a slow release. Then I showed you how you add in white vinegar. Vinegar will react with the calcium carbonate, free up plain old calcium, which then can be taken in by your plant quicker. And that would be a way that you could use eggshells to help treat blossom end rot, is that you have to use that weak acid to break the calcium carbonate so that you have calcium available for your plant. Calcium nitrate is really the addition of nitric acid to limestone. It creates calcium nitrate, which will be calcium and nitrogen, two things that are needed for your plants. It's very water soluble. It won't change the pH. It's just plain old calcium. There's no calcium carbonate in there. You can use it on your plants. I will talk about that more when I understand it better and start using it. Now, I do have some recommendations. First recommendation, I'm going to start at the bottom, use less. When you plant a plant, you can put in, you know, 2 tablespoons of garden lime from dolomitic lime. It says up to 4. Don't overdo it. Just put it into the planting hole, mix it in well. That is a great start for your plant. Same thing with the gypsum, 1 or 2 tablespoons. This talks about adding almost 1 pound to established plants. You don't need to do that. You don't need to follow these products to, you know, the perfect degree. And I also think they tend to make us think we need to use more than we have to. Just use less. You're not going to change the pH. You're going to give your plants what they need. It makes a difference. And never overuse them. You don't need to use more than the directions say. Most soils have calcium in it. So remember, when you start gardening, your garden soil is going to have most of these products. As you start growing things and you start having plants pull out nutrients, you're going to have to use these products more. Compost and water regularly. If you can compost and put organic matter, compost into your soil, keep the moisture level going, you're going to really take care of much of the problems related to calcium. If you're gardening in containers, you're going to have to use more lime or calcium carbonate, some sort of these forms. Lime itself, calcium carbonate, can raise pH. Gypsum can lower pH because of its calcium sulfate will bring it down. So this will raise pH, this will lower pH, but in order to do that, you have to be using a whole lot of it. Real quick, this is what it looks like. That's garden lime, pelleted dolomitic lime. This is gypsum. They look very similar. So I hope you understand a little bit about what garden lime can do. You can also find organic products that have NPK, calcium, magnesium, and sulfur in there. You could use this instead of those. But now I hope you have a sense of how you might use calcium in your garden and can better understand, you know, what to do. Again, I want to stress, don't overuse these fertilizers. Please check out my blog at www.therestofgarden.blogspot.com and also check out my YouTube videos. Thanks.